Chapter 7, Pistachios and Rifle Grease. Flying over the Grand Pajonal, Clyde could see dozens of small campa compounds, usually 4 to 5 huts grouped together where the Indians slept on palm leaf mats on dirt floors. Each village had its own witch doctor who exerted a strong hold on the people. One witch doctor, fearing he might lose power over his people, started a rumor. "Don't have anything to do with the airplane that flies overhead. Don't ever go to Nevada for medical treatment. If you do, Pistachios will get you. They'll put you in a big pot and blow you down until only grease is left. Foreigners will use this grease to lubricate their rifles and shotguns. Superstitious Indians believed this tale and it kept many from using the medical service provided at Nevada. Quiquincha, a campa boy about 12 years old, helped his father fell trees in the rainforest. One day, a tree fell on the boy. A limb pierced his lungs and pinned him to the ground. His father raced to the village, got a few men along with the boy's mother, and worked together. They lifted the tree off the boy. The horrified mother gasped at the sight of a piece of broken limb protruding from the huge hole in her son's back. Blood spurted from the wound, but they saw no sign of breathing. "Quincy's dead!" the mother screamed. As they carried him out, he started breathing. The superstitious parents faced a dilemma. Should they take their bleeding son to the witch doctor only a few hundred yards away? Or should they carry the boy for 3 days and nights over a rugged trail to reach Nevada and Christian medical help? They had watched the witch doctor make tobacco juice and alcohol and pray to the spirits, but they didn't see how it could heal a serious injury. Although they had heard of miracles happening in Nevada, they still feared Pistachios might cook their boy until only grease remained. But the Holy Spirit worked on the camp of hearts, and the parents collected their son, some Indian friends, and headed down the trail toward Nevada. 3 days later, the missionaries examined the boy and realized the case was more serious than they could handle. They made an emergency radio call to the mission airbase at Pucallpa. Clyde hurried to the hangar, fueled the plane, and an hour later landed at the Nevada mission station. Cringing at the sight of the boy covered with blood and filth, he asked, "You want me to fly this youngster to Pucallpa?" The wound in the boy's back was full of maggots and a piece of broken branch still lodged there. He wore a dirty kushma and his body smelled like that of a dead animal. The edges of the side of his eyelids should have been bright pink. Instead, they were almost white. The Indian boy lost a great deal of blood. Feeling sick in his stomach, Clyde helped carry the boy to the plane and laid him on the floor behind the pilot seat. Juan Eucalia, a campia translator, explained to Quincy that they would take him to the hospital. "When you start feeling better, don't run off to the jungle. Just stay there and they will bring you back to your parents." Before starting the airplane engine, Clyde asked Juan Eucali to pray. Clyde noticed the boy's mother standing behind her husband. Campa spouses seldom stand together and never put their arms around each other in public. The woman was crying. She had seen the Fernando style fly over, but she'd never been so close to an airplane before. It made the witch doctor's story seem all the more plausible. "They haven't made my boy well at all. They're putting him in the back of this device. They'll take him away and cook him down to nothing but grease. The witch doctor's right. I'll never see my son again." Clyde tapped the little fellow on the shoulder and smiled. "Hey, you little rascal, why don't you smile? Come on, be nice. I'm being nice to you. Look at this little guy. He's almost like a little animal." Questions filled Clyde's mind. Is it really worth all we're doing to try to save him? As he closed the airplane door, he glanced at the parents. Their fearful faces were painted red like all the Indians from the Grand Pajonal. The father wore a long bunch of bright bird feathers hanging down his back. Clyde started the engine and taxied off for takeoff. When he applied power, the little fellow grabbed his leg in a death grip and did not let go all the way to Pucallpa. Throughout the journey, he lay on the floor, shaking and holding Clyde's leg. "How can I ever get to a little guy like this?" he wondered. "How can we teach him anything? Can his parents even understand what God's love is all about?" Laying at the base, he taxied to the hangar, cut the engine, and coasted in. When Clyde opened the door, there stood his youngest child, 4-year-old Linda. "Oh no," he thought. "Our Linda. She seems to have the ability to play with the dirtiest children. They can be absolute filthy, yet she goes out and plays with them, and everyone has a great time." Glancing into the plane, the child smiled. "Hola, ¿cómo estás?" She didn't know the camper boy couldn't understand Spanish, but Quincy looked at her and smiled too. Clyde watched him. "Amazing! This little guy does know how to smile." The boy looked a mess. His body odor made everyone to hold their nose, but Linda thought he was great. Clyde loaded Quincy into a jeep and headed for the hospital. The doctor checked the young patient and shook his head. "I don't know how this boy's alive. You said they carried him on a trail for 3 days? Peters looked straight at the doctor. "Please do all you can to keep him alive. It would be wonderful if God would heal him and we could take him back to his parents." The doctor ordered a blood transfusion, pulled the stick out of the lung, and scraped maggots from the hole in the boy's back. Quincy felt better immediately. "Anything you think that would be impossible to live through, he already has," the doctor said. "And he's still awake and alert. We can't sew up the wound. It has been open too long and will have to heal on its own." "Won't he die with the hole in his back?" Clyde asked. "The best we can do is pray he won't. We'll give him a lot of antibiotics, and he's full of worms, and we'll need medication to take care of that too. I think he'll be better off if you just take him home and take care of him. We'll send medications with you." The mission pilot took the youngster back to the base. "Eleanor, they won't keep this boy at the hospital. Will you make a bed for him in the hangar?" "We can't do that," she said. "We don't speak Campa, and we need him in the house where we can watch him. Okay, if it's got to be that way. The Peters didn't know many good sheets, but Eleanor got out a couple of their best and put them on the bed for the young patient. This little guy doesn't even know the difference between a sheet and a blanket, her husband interrupted. He's never seen a sheet. Dear, do we have to use those good sheets for him? Yes, although we can't talk to him, we can treat him like a king. We can treat him the way Jesus treats us. Listening to Eleanor, Clyde felt ashamed. I'm amazed the Lord doesn't strike me dead. I want to leave him in the hangar, but you bring him in the house. Give him the best sheets, and I know you will give him the best food, too. The children watched their mother make the bed for the new friend. Shelley and Alan thought it was great. Linda thought it was wonderful. Quincy just smiled. They cleaned him up a little at the hospital, but he still needed a bath. Peters helped him bathe without getting any water into the wound in his back. Then Clyde showed him how to use the bathroom, because they had one of those fancy toilets you had to flush. The boy ate the food Eleanor prepared. She brought him orange juice with ice cubes. He howled when his tongue touched the ice. Having never seen ice before, and having never seen a kerosene stove, not even an old-fashioned one with wicks. When Eleanor lit a match, Quincy watched the blue flame go all the way around the wick burner. She put on a pan of water, and in a short time it started to boil. Quincy must thought, what would my mom do with one of these? At worship time that evening, Clyde peeked during prayer. They had all knelt around the bed in the living room. Quincy climbed down and knelt down by the three Peters children. Their father watched how when they folded their hands, he held it the same way. When they closed their eyes, he shut his too. Clyde felt a tear on his cheek. Do missions pay? Can Jesus save primitive people? I think the Lord is trying to humble me for the way I've been thinking. After prayer, he commented, if this boy's parents live in the United States, they will qualify for a PhD degree in the jungle survival. After breakfast, Eleanor served gravy on toast and Quincy loved it, then gave him bananas, papaya, and other things he was used to at home back in the forest. Clyde took him back to the bathroom to be sure he knew how to use all the equipment. At home, the boy went to a spring and carried water in clay pots. Now he learned how to turn a faucet and watch water fill a bathroom sink. Clyde gave him a comb and a mirror and showed him how to wash his face and comb his hair. After that, he'd go in there and comb his hair many times a day. The youngster stayed in the Peters home for 30 days. As he got better, he played outside with the children. Although he came from the heart of some Peru's wildest jungle, yet he acted like a perfect little gentleman. He loved Eleanor's cooking, and she liked to cook for him. Because of the language barrier, Clyde asked a camp teacher, spending a day at the base to talk to the boy. You're about well now, the teacher explained. The mission pilot is going to take you to the airplane and fly you back to your parents. Suddenly, Crunchy's ear-to-ear smile vanished. Oh, Clyde thought. This little guy wants to stay here with us the rest of his life. I'm not sure we can handle that. In less than an hour, the child had disappeared. We can't let anything happen to him now, Clyde worried. He's well and needs to return to his village. I'm responsible to get him back to his parents. Everybody at the base and the locals living in the area searched for the boy, but no one could find him. Lord, you know where the boy is, the Peters family prayed. Please bring him back. About an hour later, Clyde glanced down the runway and saw Crunchy running out of the jungle holding something in his hands. When the boy came closer, Clyde saw that the sling Crunchy had worn around his neck when he arrived at the airbase was still there. But now he had a big smile, bigger until any then. Boy, I'm glad to see you, Clyde said. What do you have in your hands anyway? Are you trying to work on us so you can stay a little longer? Clyde imagined all kinds of things as Quincy motioned for him to come over to the birdcage. The Peters children understood and opened its door. The boy reached in and let go of something. It was the most beautiful bird they'd ever seen. Peruvians call it Sayeti Colors, a seven-colored tanager. The boy knew he was leaving and wanted to do something special for Shelley, Alan, and Linda. He had taken a slingshot and walked around for several hours, getting himself all scratched up. Having made a softball of mud, he used it in a slingshot to knock the bird out of the air without injuring it. If I tried to do this, Clyde told his family, I'd still be making mud balls. This boy caught the bird without breaking a bone in his body and gave it to us as a gift of gratitude. He has a heart of gold. Wouldn't you like to spend eternity with someone like him? For his flight home, the boy wore his kushma and sling and carried the comb and mirror. The Peters gave him a few clothes. Although he really didn't have much, he was happy. For a month, he had watched people come and go in the airplane. Now he climbed up in the seat and fastened the seatbelt as if he had done it 100 times. The aircraft taxied to the end of the runway and turned around for takeoff. Clyde revved up the engine, wondering, is this little fellow going to get scared? The boy's face broke out in a big, contented smile. He kept looking out, and as they flew over the Patachi River, he could see dozens of dugout canoes. He patted the airplane. Kamatsu! Before long, the Fernando-style touched down in Nevada, and Clyde killed the engine. As the plane rolled to a stop, he could see Quincy's parents. People tried to hold him back, but they broke away and ran to the plane. Quincy jumped out, joining his parents. The next 20 minutes turned to one big blur of Campa. Clyde didn't understand much that anyone said, but he kept hearing such words as Senora, Alan, Shelley, Linda, and Captain. He knew the boy was talking about him and his family. Also, he assumed that Quincy must have told them about the ice cube, the white sheets, and even the toast and gravy, plus how the Peters had worshipped and talked to Jesus every day in their home. The Campa mother kept wiping away tears of joy. The missionaries had not boiled her son to a chunk of rifle grease. He was alive and well. She pushed up his kushma and rubbed her hands across the scar on his back. The hole into his lung completely healed over. The witch doctor's story about pistachios can't be true, she told Juan Yucali. And Navadi, she and her husband learned there is a god in heaven who loves campas and works with his hands and medical professionals to heal human bodies. Clyde stepped into the mission station office for a few minutes. Returning, he saw a huge pile of yucca under the airplane wing. Quincy's parents had made some kind of deal with other campas at Navadi. Juan Yucali explained, "This is a gift from them to show appreciation for what you've done for their son. It's for you, your wife, Shelley, Alan, and especially Linda." Clyde stared at it with his mouth open. "Tell this family there's enough yucca to fill 3 planes like the Fernando style. I'll take what I can. The boy lived in their home for 30 days. I didn't like the idea, but now I see. I'm the one who's receiving the greatest blessing." On the flight back to the base, he reviewed it all. "My wife and children didn't hesitate to give him their best. When I think of Quincy, I will always remember that often the people we least expect are some of the best candidates for the kingdom of heaven. Dear God," he prayed, "help me to be kind and always show love and respect to all your children." After servicing the plane, Clyde flew to Givenchy for the first time in weeks. He found the school closed. The new teacher, a young campa named Melita and trained at uni, had been in bed for several days. Having fallen after school one day, now her foot and ankle were swollen, causing severe pain. Clyde contacted Siegfried by radio and explained the situation. The men decided to fly her out to Pacalpa. An x-ray revealed a broken bone just above her ankle, so they put on a cast. The young woman stayed in the Peters home. 2 weeks later, the doctor released Melita and Clyde flew her back to Chivincia. He knew that the whooping cough epidemic had raged in nearby Poyiti. Rufino and his wife had transferred there to start a new school. "I better fly over and see how I was getting along." A huge thunderhead rose in the sky ahead. Clyde descended toward Poyiti just as torrential rain broke loose. "I can't land on this. The strip here is marginal at best." He circled a couple times and flew on toward uni. He listened to the noise of the engine and pelting rain. Then, almost as if he heard a voice in the cockpit, the word came to him. "Clyde, go back to Poyiti." "Are you talking to me, Lord?" The impression became so strong that he banked the plane and headed back. The heavy rains let up a little. Carefully, he guided the plane down under the clouds into the muddy airstrip. Water still poured off the palm thatch huts as he landed. Rufino, out of breath, raced to the aircraft. "Clyde, for 3 days we've been praying for the plane to come. My wife's sick and I'm afraid my children will die." "I'm sorry," Peters responded as he listened. "Many people in this village are ill. We heard the plane coming, and when it flew away, our hopes of getting medical attention vanished. Then we all knelt down and prayed. We were still on our knees when we heard the plane returning. God sent you." Their answer to prayer made a tremendous impression on the group of new believers who were just learning about Jesus and his love. Clyde used up all the medicine treating patients who suffered severe respiratory complications from whooping cough. Afterward, he flew out and returned with more medication. At the base that evening, he told Eleanor, "God asked me to land at Poyiti today. He's definitely guiding our aviation ministry." Often, Clyde stopped at Poyiti Yarina on the Patachi River. Each time he made the final approach, he saw a huge crocodile standing on a sandbar. "Why don't we do something about this crocodile?" he kept asking the people. But the villagers would laugh. "Don't worry, he doesn't bother anybody." They regard the situation as humorous. One day, Clyde arrived and said, "Let's go out there and kill that crocodile." The people grinned. "We don't think you can." "Come on," he urged. "I'll show you how to hunt crocodiles." He pulled out his pistol and indicated it held 6 powerful shells. "This is a real crocodile machine. I'll get the crocodile every time. Come with me, let's go." The villagers laughed, but were polite and respectful. "All right, Captain Peters, what do you want us to do?" "First, we've got to sneak out on that island." It meant that they would have to keep very low and go through mud and shallow water. The men got down on their bellies and followed Clyde across almost 1,000 feet of muck and mud. When they reached the sandy beach, they still had to crawl since the area was almost flat. Clyde tried to keep the sand out of the gun. "If we stand up, it's the end of the hunt," he explained, reaching a little rise. They peeked over and saw the big reptile still a quite way off. After backing off on their bellies, they crept closer to where the crocodile rested in the sun. "I really don't know what I'm doing," Clyde had to admit to himself. "Listen," he cautioned the natives, "I'm the only one with a gun. Your machetes will be worthless if the crocodile decides to attack." The Indians crawled alongside him and whispered, "Look, he's beyond this rise, not more than 50 feet away." The huge reptile lay there like a big old log, its eyes sticking up out of its head. As Clyde stared into them, the crocodile saw him. "I've got to do something quick," he whispered, "but I can't shoot from this position." He sat up and aimed. Splash! Before Clyde could pull the trigger, the crocodile hit the water and disappeared. "I brought these men here." Clyde fired several shots. "The least I can do is give them a thrill by making a lot of noise." The Indians laughed. "Yes, you can see," Clyde also laughed, "that I'm not a crocodile hunter." Covered with mud, they marched back to the village. Clyde placed the Magnum 357 under the seat of the plane and headed for the river to clean up. While washing, he watched the men scrubbing their kushmas. Back in the civilized world, they wouldn't stand for my foolishness, but these men are so patient and polite. The villagers acted pleased for the adventure. "Captain, we want you to join us for a real crocodile hunt when we go out at night," they suggested. Somehow, he never found the time. Continue listening.